It's Friday evening. Welcome to The Devi Show. It's another 30 minutes where we fight the good fight and then shine a light on a South African shining star. It's Friday night television, no sad news here, but just a reminder that many battles can be won and we need to proudly own and inspire pockets of brilliance. Here's what we have on the show tonight. He stands accused of taking money for building projects and then the job allegedly doesn't always get done. So you don't think it's a coincidence that all these people have the same complaints about the same issues?
No, there's no company that's infallible. I'm definitely not infallible. I'm an imperfect man. Yeah. We've made mistakes. Yeah.
Eclectic soul singer Nicole Davy, also proudly known as Boskasie, on owning her look and that Casper Nyovest duet, which went platinum.
And Casper lost his mind. He was like, I want the song on my album. I'll take another song out and put the song on.
Granny flats can be a great long-term investment or a smart way to downsize. But what happens when, after handing over the cash, the builder leaves you with an incomplete structure? Ronaldo Nokia stands accused of exactly that. Victims say that it's a pattern, with some claiming very sad endings. Controversy started swirling around Ronaldo Nokia in 2009 in the small town of Palaborwa when he hit the headlines as allegations of fraud, assault, theft, bribery and arson mounted.
No, it's not true.
Were these allegations made against you?
Yeah, they were allegations made, but it's fake news.
And in 2011, as the face of Sun Homes, it emerged he sold stands in St. Helena Bay and then allegedly ran off with the securing fees.
That was fake news. We never got any money there. In fact, I lost 60 million rand because that development didn't take place.
But for the last couple of years, he's been operating under companies Better Pod and the Granny Flat from the East Rand of Johannesburg. And the complaints are pouring in.
He's an embarrassment to the building industry. He should be removed. There's good and bad and ugly in every society. Unfortunately, this guy is totally rotten.
Claude Naidu and his wife signed up with Ronaldo's Better Pod in 2017 and asked him to build a granny flat on top of their garage for 258,000 rands.
It was always a dream. And I said, okay, honey, go for it. Use your pension money and we'll fulfill your desires.
A decision he soon began to regret. The Naidus paid in 150,000 of the 258 and were left with this shell of a building when Ronaldo walked off the project.
Nothing was done properly. We just had a structure. That's it, no roof. The picture tells 1,000 stories. Buildings, you know, that depicts what Syria looks like.
I saw the pictures.
You saw the picture.
Yeah.
Have you been there lately?
Yes.
And?
Yes.
The shell.
Yeah, well, he finished it, he says, with his own money, not
lying.
With you.
He's lying to you.
You finished it.
He's lying
so
to you.
So what I saw there,
he's
you did.
Lying to you. Let me explain something to you.
Yeah.
Claude Naidu is a scamster. He got us to do a 36 square meter contract for us. And when I went on holiday and I came back, he was busy letting us do a 70 square meter unit for him. And he wanted me to pay for it. He got caught out. The NHBRC ruled against him.
Okay.
And I've got agreements just so you can have a look at it.
When we pressed him for those agreements, Ronaldo couldn't supply them. Claude's images were mirrored over and over again with the other complainants we met dotted around Gauteng. Frans de Klerk says he paid Ronaldo 1.378 million rands to build two granny flats and a two-bedroomed house on his Benoni plot.
The two cottages were finished up to a stage where I could move people into them for rental income. The house was only foundations. The walls was about 60%, 50 to 60% complete. I had that valued by another builder, and the value of the work that he did on the main house was roughly about 210,000 rand worth.
The house was a bare shell. No roof, no floors, no finishes, and the money he'd paid came out of his pension.
Eventually, I had to take out another loan from the bank, a second bond, to the value of 700,000, and that allowed us to finish the main house. 700,000 gives you an installment of 6,000 rand per month for 25 years, which gives you roughly about 1.75 million that I need to pay back to the bank because he stole, he didn't finish the job.
For 4 years, they claimed this. Not a WhatsApp, not a phone call, not an email, not a lawyer's letter. All they do is stalk.
Brett and Vanessa Wooley paid Ronaldo nearly $500,000 for a granny flat for Vanessa's 80-year-old mother using her savings. But 2 years later, the Wooleys claimed they received a badly built structure instead.
We got a shell with a roof. I think they had put in the ceilings.
Yeah.
It was brick. They had done some of the plaster.
That house, the granny flat, was 60 squares. I've got the building plans here. It was built, completed. Then she went and made it bigger. And then for 4 years, I've heard nothing.
Everyone we spoke to claimed most of the delays were due to an unhappy workforce who often were not paid.
It would get to a Friday and then they would sit around on our property and not work because they weren't being paid. They wouldn't come back the next week because they still hadn't been paid. And so this would go on for weeks.
Some of the laborers, particularly the two of them, I assisted them in drawing up an affidavit for the small claims court. And they were successful. One was Jacob, I'll have to refer to my file, and the other one's Anyanda, and they were paid.
Jacob is a good friend of mine. He's still working for me. And if Claude didn't instigate him, we would have never had a problem. And Jacob got paid his money.
Don't you think Jacob can think for himself?
I'm asking you that question because he's working for me again.
But Jacob's wife, Belina, says that's nonsense.
Not anymore, ma'am. I'm telling you, they're coming from court. They never talk. After he paid my husband because of the court. Since then, he hasn't worked for you.
And to add insult to injury, despite the promises of building plans and certificates of compliance, none were forthcoming.
The deal right in the beginning was that he would supply building plans from the councils. That never happened. His architect drew up the plans, and I've got copies of that, but it never went into city council. So basically, all the buildings I've got, is illegal.
The deal with him was, we'll do the plans. We even drew those things in for him free of charge, but he had to get it approved.
I had a case of theft because I wanted those plans. It was essential for me to get those written plans, approved plans. And sadly, you have to approach the SAPS every now and again. How far are you? And you get one, two, three, four excuses upon excuses. I even got what they call a point out letter. If you find this individual anywhere, you can approach any police officer in your area or that you see that could actually arrest this person on site.
The plans that we had was not right anymore.
So
it had to be redone. I did it at my cost.
But where they are remains a mystery. We were handed a voice recording where his lack of respect for the people working on his projects is clearly evident.
And now that she's
what, that's
that
your
I
excuse?
Told you I'm getting the box next week. Shut the up and listen. Now you want to fuck me up now when you know I've got no box. Take your stuff, take your black,
what?
Get the off my site. I'll handle everything myself. You're don't threaten me.
Okay.
I don't get threatened.
To be quite honest, I don't know if that's me.
You dropped the K-bomb here. Ronaldo, stop the stories.
I tell you now, if I say that, I'm very sorry.
You did say that, that's
well,
your...
Well, then I'm very sorry. I didn't mean it like that. I spoke to a white person. I didn't mean it like that.
You're kidding me.
So it's what
okay
must
to,
I do?
It's okay to talk to a white person like
yes.
that and drop the K-bomb.
You're saying white people don't talk like that with each other.
I'm talking about you now.
Yeah, no, it's terrible.
Is it okay to speak to a white people about black people?
Not like that, no.
But you did.
My,
and then you denied
listen,
even your
my
voice.
Best friends...
A black.
African people.
There we go.
But they are. But they are.
Coming up, the cases and the threats mount up. Because she's living in a caravan.
And she deserves to live there because
caravan.
Of what she's done.
Welcome back. If you missed part one of our story, Ronaldo Nokia is a builder. One of his areas of speciality is the building of granny flats, but many victims who have opened up cases at various police stations argue that they've been left in the lurch. We decided to pay Ronaldo a visit just before he attended to another matter at the Boksburg Magistrates Court. When the case studies started doing their homework online, they were in for a shock.
I was very disturbed by what I found. I found some blogs. I found a whole article where he's had an interview and it's transcribed, which I see that's taken down on the IL site. I phoned an estate agency in Palabor. I just took a flyer. And the lady on the other side said to me, has money passed hands? Have you given this man any money? And she said, sit down, do not give him a cent. I said, it's too late.
And my wife and I said, hey, let's put this guy, let's do some homework, let's put him in Hello Peter. And when we went into Hello Peter, voila, we saw a few other complainants. And then we started interacting. And that's how the group was formed.
They formed a WhatsApp group with a number of complainants and physically approached the police, where it was decided to set up a class action through the Sinoville police station under the investigation of Colonel Pratt.
There was a lot of us there that day. There must have been more than 20, and the ones that couldn't be there had actually sent their police reports with the ones that were there, so there was even more. It was quite enlightening that day, actually frightening.
At the police station, they also shared voice notes of Ronaldo's threats.
Maybe you should read up on me before you threaten me, okay?
I actually wanted to walk out because some of them were quite sick.
We played some of these to him.
We can go to the criminal court and you will see your with me, okay? Let's go to court. You'll get nothing now.
Lazelle, waar op God's aarde sal 'n man soos ek jou, 'n ou lelike vrou, ooit wil sexually harass? Ek het jou 'n drukkie gegee toe ons uit was en vir jou gesê dankie vir die besigheid. Moet jouself nooit terg nie, vrou. Mens God, niemand wil jou buig of rape nie.
When a woman accuses you of sexual harassment and she's 65 years old and she's disgusting and she tries to extort you for money after she's paid your contract and not you, that is disgusting and I will lose my temper and I do not regret any word of it.
According to Colonel Pratt, the case file is currently with the National Directorate of Public Prosecutions for a decision and she expects a response soon.
Are they going to make a decision? What are they going to do? Are they going to prosecute or are they declining or are they going to refer it to the civil court?
We've got a fantastic constitution. But here, ons is baie starig with a lot of things. We are absolutely lethargic. We've got no gees. You can have facts in front of you. We just labor upon the issue.
But it seems Ronaldo didn't take kindly to the criticism on social media. And when pensioner Marty Kutsia took to Facebook to warn other consumers, he took her on.
They are elderly people. They gave their pension. This is all that they had to build their home. They're actually living in their caravan. And he has told the court and he's told everybody that he actually built them a house. They have nothing. They don't even have a slab. He built them a slab so badly that the slab cracked into a million pieces. They had to actually dig it up and take it away.
Despite this, Ronaldo managed to get an interim harassment order from the clerk of the Boksburg Magistrates Court to silence her. Social media lawyer Emma Sadlier says these orders can be abused.
You both go back to court and the person who has obtained the harassment protection order will argue why he or she wants it to be made permanent, in which case it lasts for 5 years. And the person against whom it's been obtained has the opportunity to say, actually, this wasn't harassment. Either it was warranted or the person's making it up.
If you post a complaint, all that really matters is that you can prove the following.
Firstly, it must be true. Secondly, it must be for the benefit of the public. In South Africa, we have this additional requirement of public interest. If it's warranted, by all means, take to the platforms and name and shame.
We met Ronaldo outside the Boksburg Magistrates Court. In Marty Kutsia's case, does she have her granny flat or not?
No. Let's answer that in court.
Okay.
Did she destroy herself or not?
Okay. Because she's living in a caravan.
And she deserves to live there
in a
because
caravan.
Of what she's done.
What they're all saying is that you don't finish the projects, you but take the money. Well, let me finish.
Yeah.
You don't finish the projects, you take the money, you don't want to hear from them, and then you get aggressive.
Yes, I do.
Is it a pattern? Or
no,
is
a
it
pattern.
Not
it's
a pattern.
It's not a pattern, no. Okay. Let me explain to you why not.
Okay.
If you see the amount of business we've done, it's a very small percentage. That's number one. Number two, a lot of these people has been instigated to come and complain like this.
You don't think it's a coincidence that all these people have the same complaints about the same issues?
No, of course. Things went wrong and there's complaints. There's no company that's infallible. I'm definitely not infallible. I'm an imperfect man.
Yeah.
We've made mistakes. Yeah.
Just to summarize, all these people have all these complaints. They're all talking nonsense.
No. Some of them have got valid complaints.
Who's valid?
No, I can't go through that now.
It's disgusting. And you know, I always say the fact speaks louder than words. So he blatters a hell of a lot. Maybe in this instance he can, she's an elderly couple, he thinks he can bully them. But she must be steadfast in her approach and say, sorry, I will not let my guard down.
Building is not a cheap exercise. Do your homework. And I know we've said this so many times on the show, but the truth is, once the money is gone, it's gone. And the chances to recoup can be an expensive undertaking, which is why so many people just give up. After the break, her name is Boskasie. Yep, you heard right, Boskasie. Her duet with Casper Nyovest went platinum, and she has even bigger dreams in her pretty head. Nicole Davy grew up in a family of jazz lovers in Cape Town, but life experiences made her realize that she needed to own every single facet of her being. Tonight, meet Boskasie. She's hitting the big time, and we're really excited to remind you of the young energies we have in our country. There's a deep soul to her sound, with the innovation of a new generation. Born Nicole Davy, singer, songwriter and self-taught guitarist Boskasie hails from Kales Rivier in the Cape. Growing up in a jazz family, her mother was a trumpeter and her father a vocalist and guitarist for the Boys Brigade, she stepped into the musical scene with her first EP, Memoirs, in 2016. So glad that I took a chance on you. Even after all that you put me through. Give me a little bit of your background in terms of music and some of the big names you grew up with.
In my household in Cape Town, where I grew up, there were always, like you said, big names. Abdullah Ibrahim, Jimmy Tludlu, Yuma Sikela, Nora Jones, Michael Jackson. So we had the old school ballads, and then we had the authentic Cape Town sounds, the Cape jazz, which was very much a thing in our house.
Boskasie and her mother moved to the Netherlands when she was just 11 years old, and that experience shaped her. What was it like living in the Netherlands?
It was my first time overseas, so the way that influenced me, and I think the way that influenced the way I see people and understand culture, also helped write my music. There was always a sense of being African, I was less than. They used to call me neger, which means the N-word in Dutch.
Right.
It used to be a joke. But when I had a chance to reflect on it, I realized that this was very derogatory and rude and disrespectful.
How did that experience, though, change the way you saw yourself?
I'm proud. I don't want to have straight hair like they had. You know, now I can own my Africanness because I'll be on African soil and I can be like my people. Finally, I'll fit in. But I guess the joke was on me because I came back to Cape Town only to find that my own people being, you know, colored people are aspiring to look like them. So there was a complete mismatch of identity for me. Owning my roots, owning the fact that I was Khoisan. But when I mentioned Khoisan at my high school, they were like, we're not Khoisan. It felt like I was standing on my own as someone that's proud to be African, on African soil and koi, but there was no one else that actually looked like this in an identity space.
And in rediscovering her roots, she found not only her voice, but her distinctive look and standout stage name, Boskasie, was born.
What does Boskasie mean?
Big hair, bushy hair, unkempt, untamed hair. So that term was used to describe hair in a very derogatory sense. When I was coming up with the stage name, I was like, this is a powerful way for me to change the discourse around this word and use it as a stage name, not only owning the word, but owning my hair, owning my roots, owning the way our aunties and our grandmothers looked down on us, our communities looked down on us for the way we looked, and owning it and saying, we can look like this. It's okay, guys, I got you. Searching for the
answer. Describe your sound.
So I've never wanted to box myself. So I see myself, my sound is very eclectic. And one thing that remains constant in this mixture of sounds is my lyrics. They are always soulful. So I call my sound eclectic soul. My heart is crying
out in despair. Her hit, Move For Me, came about while messing around in her lounge with her creative team after a studio boot camp.
I think we were going out that night, so I was busy getting done, and Phantom was like, can you just come here and sing a line? So I was like, sure.
Just one line.
Just one line. I came and sang the line, which happened to be, oh, I like the way you move for me, move for me. Oh, I like the way you move for me.
So it was no surprise when Casper Nyovest wanted to feature her sultry voice on his colossal hit, Move For Me.
Phantom was in studio with Casper the one day having a meeting about dancing. Like, at this point, he's about 99% done with his album. You know, so he's just finishing touches, whatever. And Phantom asked him if he could play him this song. Yeah. And Casper was like, yeah, sure. And Casper lost his mind. He was like, I want this song on my album. I'll take another song out and put this song on. And I remember Phantom phoning me like, remember that song we made the other day? Casper wants it.
Move For Me went platinum and threw a spotlight on Boskasie, but the singer refuses to lose herself in the glare or forget who she really is deep in her soul.
Own who you are, own your hair, own your body, own your gender, or if it's non-binary, own that because you have that right, and let us not allow whatever other forces are out there to determine that for us.
Young talents, people owning their corner and wearing their skin with such pride, and we just love that. And on that note, that's where we sign off. We'll be back next Friday, but please do share your story ideas or thoughts on the show via devi@etv.co.za. From me and the Devi team, until next time, heads up South Africa. Let's keep our eyes fixed on the horizon. We've got this.